My son's baby monitor alerted and I saw my wife and son, they weren't my family. Hi there, did you wander onto this YouTube video wanting to hear a story, scary enough to send chills up your spine? If so, my friend, you are in the right place. Welcome to my channel. Today, we've got another story from our /NoSleep. Before we start, if you have some scary personal experiences that you want to share, feel free to email them to me. Let's get started. Original story. I'm a nurse and I currently work nights. It's a total drag, but I'm hopeful I can go to days soon since some coworkers are planning retirements. Anyway, I was working one night when just after 3 a.m. my son's monitor alerted me to sound and movement. No big deal at all, he probably coughed loudly or sneezed or something. He's 3 now, so he generally sleeps all night. I bring it up on my phone and I see him and my wife sitting on the bed. Again, no big deal. He might have cried out or gotten scared or something. I was about to close the app when I noticed they were acting strange, almost creepy. And when I say almost creepy, I mean creepy as balls. They were sitting on the bed together, both of them just staring up at the camera with blank, emotionless stares. The night vision is black and white, so they had white, eerie looking eyes. They didn't move at all aside from their visible breathing, they just sat there staring at the camera. I close the app and give my wife a call to make sure everything is okay. I never get to call home on lunch, so in a way this is kind of nice to get to talk to my family while at work. It rings a couple of times before she answers with a very groggy hello. It was like she was dead asleep when I called and she looked wide awake when on the camera. Hey. You guys okay? Huh? Yeah. Buddy, my son's nickname, came in like 15 minutes ago. Seemed scared, so I said he could sleep with mama. I'm confused here since I saw them in his room a minute ago. Literally, 60 seconds had passed since I closed the app and made the call. Wait, so you guys are in bed? Yeah, I fell back asleep right away. Is everything okay? Everybody keeps waking me up. She's kind of annoyed. Hang on a second, I put her on speaker and bring up the app, hoping I don't see it. When the app loads, I get that pang of intense nervousness in my stomach that I haven't had in a long time since I was a kid in school and realized while I was eating breakfast a paper or something was due that day and I hadn't done it. My heart leaps into my throat. My wife and son are sitting on his bed looking up at the camera, same emotionless stares. Hello? You guys are in bed, right? Yeah, we're trying to sleep. Well, I'm looking at his camera and I see you two sitting on his bed. Huh? No. We're in our bed, I know that's what you mean, but I'm looking at his bed and you two are in there. Hang on, she says. She's quiet for a second while she brings up the camera on her phone. I hear this guttural, terrified gasp. Like she had sucked all the air in the room into her lungs, filling them to capacity. I don't hear this kind of gasp from my wife often, usually only when she's truly afraid, like during a jump scare in a movie, or one time when we turned her back on our son for literally a second and he was down by the mailbox inches from the road. I hear the rustling of sheets and the line goes dead. Of course, now I'm absolutely terrified myself, so I immediately call back. It goes to voicemail, so I call again. I call again and again with no answer. Finally, after about 4 minutes, she calls me. I tell you that 4 minutes felt like 40 years. Hey, what's happening? I ask. She's absolutely hysterical and crying, I can't understand a word she says.
Stop. Slow down for just a second, I say.
She slows down enough to explain they are in the car and driving to her parents. She looked at the camera and when she saw what was on it, she got up and grabbed our son and rushed downstairs and out the door. Didn't even close the garage. Don't worry about it, I said. I'll drive by when I get off and close it. We live in a generally safe neighborhood, so I'm not too concerned the door is up. You will not go in there, she says. Hell no, I return. Why are we on the camera? She asked. Is it a recording? I don't know, I return. I'm gonna keep watching it and see if there's anything I can tell. Do our code words with Buddy. We have code words because we're nerds. We've seen too many pod people and imposter movies, so we decided a long time ago to make code words with each other to be able to tell if one of us was an imposter. We have a couple of code words, but we also have a 3-sentence story we recite together, each saying a different part alternately of each other. I hear her on the phone saying the things we taught our son, he giggles as he says them, he does every time we practice, since he thinks they're a joke and doesn't have any idea of the real meaning. We're both convinced he's our son. My wife then says our part and I'm convinced she's her. We made up these words as a complete joke to ourselves. I never once in my life ever imagined we'd actually need them. Unreal. She got to her parents safely and it was hard to hang up. I told her we'll figure it out in the morning, hopefully just a glitch. She said she didn't think it was a glitch. When she was running out, she had to run by her son's room and the door was open. There's a little flashing light on the back of the camera that indicates it is connected to the internet. It gives off just enough light that when she ran by, she thought she saw, out of the corner of her eye, a shadowy outline of what could have been an adult sitting on our son's bed. It sends chills down my spine to think about. Knowing they were safe and out of the house is the only thing that kept me at work that night. It was a long 4 hours, but I kept checking the camera every chance I got. Sure enough, they were still sitting on the bed staring up at the camera with emotionless gazes. I studied them to see if I could see any pattern, from their breathing to their blinking. Their breathing was steady and looked normal. It was their blinking that would tell me if this was just some kind of bizarre, time-looped freak accident video or not. I intently stare at my phone and count the seconds between each blink, telling myself if this is a loop then their blinks should be even and occur at the same time each time. There was no pattern to their blinking, it was erratic and random, just as a person blinking should be. The passing hours are what finally sealed the deal that this was not a weird looped video of some kind. My son's window is visible on camera and I can see on camera that it is getting lighter outside his room. His curtains keep out just enough light to prevent the camera from exiting night vision, but lets in just enough to be able to tell the sun is rising. I try to figure out what the hell I'm going to do before I leave work. Calling the police comes to mind, but I talk myself out of it. First of all, what am I supposed to say? Someone is in my house that looks like my wife but isn't. Worse yet, what if they are entities of some kind and the police do go over and it kills them or something? I decide to tell a coworker about it. He's a firm believer in the paranormal and might have a suggestion. I show him the video and tell him the story. His initial response of "that's creepy as fuck" doesn't help much, but he says he wants to go over and check it out. He says we both should see if not my wife will try and act like my wife. I tell him absolutely not, and he says we should at least go to the house even if we don't go in. I agree with that since I wanted to close the garage. We got to my house and walked around the perimeter first. Not sure what we wanted to accomplish by that, but it felt like something we should do. The curtains were all drawn since nobody was there to open them in the morning, so we couldn't see anything. I went to close the garage and suddenly had this overwhelming urge to go inside and investigate. It was like I just had to know what was going on. So when we went, we walked through the kitchen towards the foyer where the stairs are. It's so quiet in our house right now you could hear a feather drop, forget the pin. We stop at the bottom of the stairs and wait a few seconds. I look at the camera again and they're still sitting there. I've never been so scared in my life. My coworker puts his foot on the first step and I suddenly say stop loudly. Forget this, we're out of here, I tell him. Come on, I start making my way back to the kitchen. We hear a loud creak in the floor from upstairs. It's my son's room. He has a very loud, creaky board right in the middle of his floor that's almost impossible not to step on. My wife and I are still deciding if we ever want to fix it because it will alert us if he's ever up to no good when he gets older trying to sneak out or something. Come on, come on, come on. I yell as I motion for him to move his ass. We're out of the house in about 2 seconds. Out on the street, I check my phone. Now only not my son was sitting on the bed, same blank stare. Not my wife was gone. Holy shit. My coworker says. That was stupid as fuck of us. Do not tell my wife we went inside. She would be so ungodly mad if she found out what we just did. I use my garage door opener in my car to close the door. Before we leave, I look at the camera again. Not my wife is back on the bed with not my son, both staring blankly up at the camera, blinking every few seconds. That was all about 4 days ago now. Not my wife and not my son are still sitting on the bed staring up at the camera. They haven't moved a millimeter. We obviously haven't gone back to our house. What do we do? Update. I'm sorry it's taken so long, it's been an emotional month. I've felt like I'm losing my mind, or already lost it. I've been in the hospital for 3 weeks. You'll remember I left off at my wife's parents' house not sure what the hell to do. My wife and I argued about it, my in-laws said to call the priest. I told my wife we're calling the cops and that's it. The day we finally called the cops would be day 6. Not my family was still sitting on the goddamn bed, staring at the camera. I told the dispatcher there were intruders in my house, leaving out the part where they looked exactly like my family. I told her we were out of the house but I would meet the police there. She dispatched 2 units. My wife begged me not to go. I told her I had to be there, I had a foolproof plan. I would take her mom's iPhone and FaceTime with my wife while showing the police the camera on my phone. They would see this as a fucked up situation and hopefully proceed with caution. My coworker's friend said he would come with me as well. My friend and I beat the cops to my house. Like most of you mentioned in the comments previously, I was packing heat. I have concealed carry, so I had my 1911.45 on me. I was not concerned this would bother the cops, as I was going to inform them of my permit and that I was currently carrying. What I wasn't going to tell them was that I had my father-in-law's AR-15 in my trunk. It's almost funny how many of you mentioned that was the way to go in my previous entry. I didn't plan on telling the cops about it because I was not planning on needing it. They would come armed and prepared. They showed up and I let them know I was armed and then enacted my plan. I initially told them the story. They looked at each other like I was crazy and they didn't believe me. I FaceTimed my wife so they could see she was in fact not in the house despite what our camera was showing. They still didn't seem to believe me, but this did pique their interest. I hung up with my wife and told her I'd call her back as soon as we knew something. So now we're sure this isn't a recording, an officer stated, repeating what I said. It's not. The day/night cycle has changed every day. Their blinking is erratic and not cyclical like it was a repeat, I said. I know it's a stupid question, but your wife isn't a twin? The other officer asked. I told him no. My friend spoke up. I have an idea. Turn the volume up, I'll go throw a pebble at the window. He went around back while I turned up the volume to the max. Okay, I'm tossing. We heard the light tick sound from outside, but the 1 second delay on the camera came in loud and clear through my phone. Not my wife moved at the sound of the pebble hitting the window, the first time I'd actually seen her move aside from the time she wasn't on screen when I initially went inside our house the first day. She turned her head towards the window just slightly, before turning back to the camera. Okay, so this is Liv, an officer said. Okay sir, I need you and your friend to stay outside here. We're going to go in and find out what's going on here. Should you ask for more units? I asked hopefully. Not at this time. We're going to assess the situation first, they don't appear to be armed but we're going to be cautious. I opened the garage for them and they made their way in towards my kitchen door. They radioed dispatch that they were headed in and to stand by. They disappeared into my house. A few seconds after they went in, the camera went out. I wanted to vomit and I felt like if I put my fingers in my mouth I'd be able to feel my heart since it had leapt so far up into my throat. Shit. I yelled to my friend. I immediately popped the trunk and got my rifle out and ran into the garage, my friend right behind me. We got inside just in time to hear a low, guttural howl from upstairs, demonic sounding almost, along with raised voices from the police. There were several shots. Need backup, shots fired. He was cut off. Oh my god. My friend howled. He was scared shitless, but so was I. God fucking damn it, I knew it. I said, running up the stairs. My son's room is the first one you come to after getting upstairs, so his wall is also what you see as you walk up the stairs. As I reached the top, I laid into the wall with my rifle. It has a 30-round magazine, but I felt like I fired 100 shots. I fired all over the place, knowing full well the ammo would go through the wall like it was paper, concentrating on where my son's bed would be but also near the door and towards the floor as well in case whatever these things were thought to duck. We heard shrieks of pain coming from the room, then nothing. My friend and I paused for a minute before deciding to go in because the camera was still out. We heard a whimpering coming from the room. There was a dead cop in the hallway we had to step over. It was awful and I'll never be able to unsee it. His head was several feet away from his body on the threshold to our guest room. We found the other cop in my son's room right inside the doorway. He had several large holes in his torso as if he'd been impaled. Exactly what I was afraid would happen had happened. I called the cops and whatever these things were killed them. When we entered the room, we found the source of the whimpering was not my wife. She was laying on her back on the floor, holding her torso that was bullet-ridden and breathing heavy. The scene was awful. I can hardly put into words how awful it was. I know now, just like I did then, they weren't my family. It shouldn't have been hard. I should have been able to just go in and finish it, but instead, I fell to my knees. Not my wife begged for her life. I don't want to die, honey, she whimpered. I wanted to have more kids, I can't die now. I looked over at not my son, who had to be dead. He'd taken 2 shots at least to the head, or what was left of it. He had several more in his torso and 1 or 2 on his legs and arms. If you have kids, seeing their lifeless, bullet-ridden bodies is a special kind of hell. Again, I knew it wasn't my son, but it was. I was going to be sick. I'd killed my family. I turned back to not my wife, she was acting just like my wife. It even mimicked her anxiety about death that she has had in the past year or so. It's not her, man. I forgot my friend was even there. It's not her, shoot it. I know what you guys are thinking. How many times has this happened in the movies and you scream at your TV for the main character to just shoot the imposter because it's not their loved one? I guess movies get it right somehow. I'll never roll my eyes at the character who can't kill an imposter again. Please don't shoot me, it begged. My hands were shaking as I aimed at it. Why couldn't I do it? I know, I knew, this wasn't my wife. Listen, man, my friend began calmly. Look at it, its blood is yellow. It's not your family. Was it yellow? It was. Seeing my family slain was so traumatic I hadn't even noticed their blood wasn't red. I steadied my aim and not my wife suddenly stopped begging. She began that guttural, terrifying shriek, and something black or gray started to protrude from her mouth, like a tentacle or something, and I fired. At that range, her head more or less exploded. Whatever these things were, they appeared to be mortal. I was still on my knees and my friend was out in the hallway just outside the door. We heard the sounds of approaching police sirens. I'd forgotten one of the cops had gotten a shots fired call over the radio before being killed. It seemed like it had been hours, but it had only been about 5 minutes since the police had gone in. My friend went downstairs to let the police know what to expect. I stood up and slowly made my way into the hallway. I was lightheaded and felt like I was going to be sick. My bedroom is adjacent to my son's, so the doorway is about a foot to the right of my son's doorway. My door was closed, but as I exited my son's room, my door opened. Nami walked out into the hallway, wearing exactly the same thing I was at that time. I was shocked in place. I couldn't move, but it did. It walked towards me and its right arm turned black and morphed into what appeared to be a tentacle. It was wiggling around like a squid or octopus appendage. When he thrust his arm at me, it solidified and impaled me through my abdomen. It then stabbed me in the left leg just above the kneecap. I fell to the ground in pain. Its tentacle arm was wiggling again. "Why did you kill my family?" it asked. When it spoke, its voice changed pitch several times. It was my voice, then much deeper, then normal again. It alternated several times saying that one sentence. It moved in closer. The rifle was gone, but I still had my .45. I pulled it out and got a shot off in its right knee. It howled. As Nami fell to his knee, I fired a couple more shots, getting two into its abdomen and left side of its ribs. It breathed heavily for a few seconds before I used the last of my strength to aim properly and shot Nami in the face. Its blood was also yellow. I lay there bleeding out, thinking this was it for sure. I still had some strength from adrenaline kicking in, so I took my belt off and tried to make a tourniquet for my leg. With my stomach wound, it was hard to give it a good yank to tighten it. I then took my shirt off and balled it up and packed my stomach wound and applied as much pressure as I could. Being a nurse probably saved my life. I passed out, but the measures I took must have kept me alive long enough for EMS to arrive. I heard raised voices and the sound of pounding coming up the stairs before I went out. It was probably a cop, but I felt pressure from somebody trying to keep my wound packed before I went out. I was in and out of consciousness as EMS arrived, along with probably every cop in the city. I was wheeled downstairs and put in an ambulance, but while I was being loaded onto the gurney upstairs, I heard cops freaking out, and rightfully so. They'd lost two brothers and there were three other bodies. Did he kill his brother? Are they twins? Probably referring to Natmi's dead body. Or his whole family. Put him on armed guard while at the hospital. He'll probably be getting charged. As I was getting placed into the ambulance, I saw my friend talking to a group of about 10 cops, all listening very intently to what he was saying. I went out again in the ambulance. I woke up in the ER, my wounds had been treated. The tentacle hadn't been more than a few inches wide, so it was just slightly larger than a large knife. They'd sewn me up and I found that I was currently receiving a blood transfusion due to blood loss at my home. My wife had authorized them to do whatever they had needed while I was unconscious. She was also extremely, extremely pissed that I went in the house. We're okay now, but that's a story for another day. I was in the hospital for 3 weeks since I ended up getting an infection and almost went septic. I needed quite a few antibiotics. For the entire 3 weeks, I had cops in my room with questions. After about a week, they released me and no longer had me under armed guard. I told them absolutely everything, not caring if it made sense or not, and thank God my friend had come with me since he was able to corroborate this weird story. Midway through my hospital stay, men with suits came to pay me a visit. They were government, I knew right away. They said they were FBI, but I don't know if I believe that. They wanted to talk about not my family. The police chief and the coroner were involved and it was very hush-hush. They made it clear this was not to get out to the public. This is where I have to apologize probably for an anticlimactic ending to this ordeal. I don't know what not me and my family were. Neither do they. The only thing we know is that they were sentient creatures that looked like us and had yellow blood. I begged the coroner to tell me about their autopsies, but he said he wasn't allowed to say. He must have felt bad for me since I received a bouquet of flowers a couple of days later. The card inside the envelope read, "We don't know what they are. They have the same organs we do but in different parts of their body aside from their brain, but what's red and pink inside us is green and yellow inside them. They're humanoid creatures, but whatever they aren't human. The government thinks they may be extraterrestrial. Destroy this letter ASAP." We had our house professionally cleaned. It was almost surely a government team since they contacted us on behalf of the police. We could not find any Google reviews or websites for the company online. My wife and I are not going to go back to our house. We would love to burn it down, but there's no way to do that and avoid suspicion of arson at this point. We'll end up taking a huge loss on the property since everyone in our neighborhood knows there was an incident involving multiple deaths in the house but doesn't know what actually happened. It'll be hard to sell, but eventually, it will. We're going to move on from here. I told everyone at work it was a home invasion and they bought it. I'll go back to work in a couple of weeks and we'll start looking for a new house. Again, I'm sorry. I know everyone wanted a concrete ending and can know exactly what the fuck those things were. But we just don't know. Aliens sound good to me. I've been thinking if they were supernatural or actual demons, gunfire wouldn't have been able to kill them. It's just hard to say. If they were aliens, why did they just sit there and creep in our house for a week? They didn't even try to take over our lives. It's hard to wrap my head around. If it is aliens, keep your eyes peeled out there. There could be more of them. Did you get your dose of scariness? Don't forget to hit the like button on your way out. Also, what do you think about this story? What did you feel while listening to this? Let us know in the comments down below. If you like the video, subscribe to the channel to see more videos like this. Hit the notification bell to make sure you never miss an upload.